Okay, thank you very much. Okay, we have seen some nice geometric example. Let's go on with another kind of example I'm going to talk about, that are Kummer surfaces. Okay, Kummer surfaces. So as I said, I will do the construction, well, in the projective setting, because I started with projective surfaces, but actually everything I'm going to say, it works also in the non-projective setting. So let's take A, an abelian surface. So you know that, again, A is C modulo lambda, C2, where lambda is a rank 4 lattice. Okay. Then there is an evolution on A. On A, induced by I go from C2 to C2 and to X and Y I associate minus X minus Y. Okay, I call this involution, let's say, iota and iota in the same way here. Okay, it's a preserve, of course, the lattice, and it sends me an involution here. Involution so means E squared equal the identity. Now let's look at the fixed locus of this involution on A. So the points x, y in A that are fixed by iota satisfy this means that x, y, if it's fixed, x, y equal minus x minus y in A. So this means that 2 times x, y is, let's say, in lambda. Okay, is equal to 0 in A, so it's lambda. So these are what they call the point of order 2. Are the points of order 2 on A. And it's easy to see that you have 16 of them. And we have you can just really write down, if you write down the lattice, you can see which are the points. And we have 16 of them. So now we start considering a diagram. I will tell you what I'm going to write. Okay, here I have A. And I have iota the involution. Let's consider now the quotient. So this is A modulo I. And this surface, I call it Z. Then I write down the properties of this diagram. So this map I call, I don't need. So I will, yes, let's call pi. I need more space. So this is pi. So the properties are, and this let's call P1, P16 the fixed points. So we denote them. By P1, P16. Okay. Then first properties that we, if you look at the image of this point in the quotient, we have 16 A1 singularities. So let me just recall what I mean by A1 singularities. These are the singularities that locally looks like the vertex of a cone. So it's something like this, or rational double points. Okay. Why that? It's an exercise. Okay, we will discuss why this quotient are exactly A1 singularities. We'll discuss it in in the exercise section on Wednesday. One can look at the local coordinate and then describe exactly what these are. Then I can make here the minimal resolution. So this means that I resolve the 16 A1 singularities, but I don't do anything more. So I don't add minus one curves, for example. Let's call this Z tilde. And this, I give the name of beta tilde. So zeta tilde is the minimal resolution. But in fact, we have this diagram has a nice property that you can also go the other way around. So we can take here the blow up in P1, P16. So this is the blow up, and I call this A tilde. So A tilde, this is a blow up in a smooth point, contains 16 minus 1 curves. Okay, those are smooth curves. And iota induces an action on A tilde. Let's look how. So where I have to think how to do that, I have to think about how to do that in the blow up, because outside the blow up, well, I have an automorphism that is like iota, and I want to do it here. An automorphism, an action, an involution, better, an involution, iota tilde on A tilde. And how to see that? Well, assume, let's do a local computation. Pi, I blow up in a Pi equals 0, 0. Let's say, assume, let's do in, in P1 equal, assume 0, 0. Have you chosen your coordinates such that P1 is equal to 0, 0. Then how looks the blow up at this point? Well, this is x0, x1, x and y in P1 cross C2 such that x0, y is equal to x1, x. Okay. And the action, which is the induced action? Well, I want an evolution that outside makes the same as iota and it respects the equation. So this is iota tilde. Let's send x0, x1, xy. Well, to x0, x1, nothing happened here. And minus x, minus y. If you look, this is it's well defined because I put a minus sign here, so the equation is preserved, and so it preserves the blow up. And in any point, I consider this action. And one remarks that iota tilde fixes the 16 minus one curves. Equal to, let's say, beta minus one of pi. EI equal to 116. Okay, you see back, because this is zero and nothing happened there. So in fact, this diagram closed. Well, that the quotient of A tilde with this iota tilde is smooth. So this is A tilde. This comes a theorem from Chevalier, because here I fix a curve. So this involution fixes completely a curve. So it's a reflection on this curve. And so the quotient is where I can have a singularity is smooth there. What does not happen here, for example. Okay. So this is really the quotient by iota tilde. And let me say something again about something more. The image of the 60 minus 1 curves. Okay, I have P1, P16, so they call this A1, A16. Okay, so this is beta minus 1 of P1. This is beta minus 1 of P16. So the image of these curves are the curves on Z tilde that resolve the singularities of the quotient. So, and so P tilde of EI is equal to DI, where DI square, one can compute, is equal to minus 2, and DI square is equal to, well, let me call the point, here I have P1, P16, so here I will call you Q1, Q16. This is the image of P1, and this is the image of P16. So these are the singular point, and then I have beta tilde minus 1 of QI. So are essentially the curve resolving the singularities. And remark, so it's how to compute that. Well, one can compute that. Well, one can show that the diagram commutes. So you know that by resolving a one singularity, you get a curve, which is a P1. This is the same as P1. Of self-intersection minus 2. But one can compute also using the diagram. This is a 2-to-1 map. And then some of the self-intersection is multiplied by minus 2. This, I am in the ramification. Okay? And, okay, so I think I told you everything we need. So we remark also that this P tilde this follows from the construction that P tilde is a double cover of Z tilde ramified on, well, the divisor that comes from this curve. So here I have the A1, A16, here I have a D1, D16. On the divisor D1 plus D16. And any time, if you again think about how to construct double cover, cyclic covering somehow, this means that D1, D16 divided by 2 is an element. Let me write down, it's not maybe very important now, but I just want to write down. So in particular, D1 plus D16 is what is called a divisible divisor, because this is the narrow severity group, or the Picard group, let's say. Oh, no, talking about the tilde. Okay, I wouldn't want to say very much about that, but anytime you have this cyclic covering, ramifying on something, this means this divided by 2 is in the Picard group. And we will see later that since this is K3, this is also the Neron-Severi group. So this is what one calls divisible class. Okay, so I have a diagram like that. So I have got a surface Z tilde. And what I wanted to, well, to show now is that z tilde is K3. So first of all, z tilde definition, z tilde is a whole Kummer surface. It is a Kummer surface associated to the abelian surface, but as I say, just think about Torrey, you can do exactly the same to the abelian surface A. And the proposition is that z tilde is K3. Okay, maybe I will try to give an idea or how to show that. Maybe I will leave you, at least see that first, that canonical class is trivial, and then I will leave us an exercise that irregularity is zero, because the computation actually is very similar we did for the double plane, so you can start computing the topological Euler characteristic of z tilde, that again one can show is 24, as it should be. Again, is a kind of topology in cutting curves and adjoining topology somehow. And then Noether formula. So again, this will be an exercise. So let's show that K z tilde, we want to show that K z tilde is trivial. Okay, let's think about that. Well, you have on the abelian surface a two form, dx wedge dy, that has no zero. So it's that gives you a trivialization of the canonical divisor. Okay, so consider the two form, the x wedge dy on A, which is a iota invariant. I'll give you an idea of what I'm going to do, and then I will do some local computation. Then consider beta star the x wedge dy. This we will see concretely that it is a iota tilde invariant. So you will see in a minute that it is so. And so this means that it comes when you have a form here that is invariant and you do some quotient by some group, then this means that this form comes from form on the quotient that may be zero poles where you have blow up or where on the divisor here that come from the blow up are sent to the ramification divisor here, because it's the only way, place where you change something. So it is iota tilde invariant, so that there is a meromorphic function, form, not function, alpha on a z tilde, it's a two form, such that when I do the pullback of that, so it is p tilde alpha. Again, I will do the computation, we'll see in a minute, is equal beta star dx with dy. And now what I want to show is, in fact, that this two form is a global form that has no zero and poles, to say that then the canonical class is trivial. Okay, one needs to check where this can have zero poles. Well, along the EI, this is the only place where I change something. So let's do some local computation. So remember how we brought A tilde locally? So one wants to show, or it is enough to check check it at the for alpha. Okay, normal form alpha is enough to check it, so poles or zeros at ZDI. So let's go back to the local computation I did above. So I was writing A tilde in that way. So we wrote, let me write it again, A tilde in that way. So x0, x1, x and y, such that x0, y is equal to x and x. So in the chart, x1 different from 0. Well, first of all, the map A tilde A beta send your coordinate x0 and y, I take this as coordinate, x is then a function of the both, to x0, y, so x and y. So what is the pullback? We can just compute now the pullback of that. So that the pullback of this form, the x wedged y, is the following. Well, x is this. So this gives me y, dx0 wedged y. Okay. And you see, well, already the first claim I did is iota tilde invariant, you see immediately, because the action was x0, x1, nothing happened, and I said minus x minus y. So this is, you see immediately it is invariant. But let me write down again in another way. So this is the following. I can write as a half dx0 wedge d y square. Okay. But now let's look at what is the map from A tilde to Z tilde around the exceptional divisor EI and the divisor DI. But let's say locally again at this EI DI. A tilde to Z tilde. So here the coordinate 0 and y send to x0 y square. Okay, remember, here I'm considering the EI. So when this is 0, x is also 0, and I get the equation of the exceptional set. And actually, the exceptional set EI is above the DI, and this is where I ramify. So that's why I have this map. So this y square equal to 0 tell me that it's ramification. Remember, just to have an idea, when I was giving you the covering, the equation of the K3 as a double cover of P2, ramified in a sextic, you have the equation T square equals something. And this square tells you, well, it's 2 to 1 outside, but when the ramification is 0, it's just the 2 points glue. So that, in fact, this is just a pullback of a form below. I have dx0 wedge dy square of alpha. And you see that this alpha, as we say, where can I have 0 in poles? But, well, along the ramification locus. And I don't have it. Okay, so this alpha is not has no 0 non-poles. Alpha has no zeros and no poles. So this means that Ks is equivalent to 0. I have a two form that is never 0, and it's not S, I was used to S, Z tilde. Equal to 0. So that the first condition for being K3 is satisfied, because the canonical divisor is trivial. The second part of the proof would be in showing that, so this is one, we want to show. That Q z tilde equal h0 omega 1 z tilde is equal to 0. And this I lead you as an exercise. I say it's exactly more or less the same way of arguing as in the case of the K3 double plane. Exercise. So use a topology. To compute key top z tilde, and then Noether formula. Well, one will see immediately that key top is 24. Again, one can compute that. And Noether formula will tell you that H0 omega 1 is H0. So these are K3 surfaces, a nice example of that. Some remark on some remark on Kummer surfaces. So you see that one interesting property there is that you see again, well, if we have the diagram, I don't want to erase the diagram, so let me maybe leave this here, well, here. One interesting fact, when you look at the in your diagram, so z tilde contains 16 minus 2 curves. So remarks. First one, z tilde, the Kummer surface, contains 16 disjoint minus 2 curves, or let's say even rational curves, isomorphic to P1 curves. Okay, you have this comes all from the blow up, and Nikulin was showing in a paper in the 80s that the converse is also true. So take SK3. Containing 16 disjoint rational curves. When I mean rational curves, again, is smooth, everything is smooth. Rational curves. Then S is the Kummer surface. Okay, the notation of, I did not told you that, but the notation for a Kummer surface is you denote this, so this is the notation, standard notation. This is a KMA, I'm just writing this way. This KM for Kummer A. S is the Kummer A, so KMA, for some abelian surface A. So this characterizes where here?
Where
in your construction? No, I use it that that I have this form, this unique form, to show that the canonical class is trivial. I use it for to having all those involution. You mean projective?
Yes, projective.
No. I said at the beginning I do the construction in the projective case, but it works exactly the same in the non-projective setting. No, I said at the beginning. So I just I want to be coherent with my. Notation somehow just work in the projective, but no, I never use it. So that's work exactly the same, and here you can again replace by Torrey instead of abelian surface. Okay, so this is in fine. It's an if and only if. Maybe let me now is a good point maybe to recall an interesting question of Shioda. So this is it's a school, but I just maybe wanted to give you also an idea of some research. So an interesting question is the following. Question of Shioda, 1977, I think. Assume that S is a K3 surface, which is a Kummer surface. Is it possible to have two abelian surfaces that are not isomorphic but give you the same Kummer surfaces? So assume S is Kummer. Does exist A and B abelian? With Kummer A, S equal to Kummer A equal Kummer B, but A not isomorphic to B. Okay, this is a very natural question. You can ask that. Is it possible that a different abelian surface give the same Kummer surface? Well, the answer is yes. And, well, maybe let's formulate this question in a different way. So that's question one. So question one is equivalent to say, to the following question two. Does there exist non-isomorphic set of disjoint, does there exist non-isomorphic sets of 16 disjoint rational curves? Because in fact, so in the proof of Nikulin, he showed that anytime you have 16 disjoint rational curves, you can do this double cover, you branch double cover, and then you get you go back to an abelian source. You have a diagram like that. So given to this two K3 that are not isomorphic, is the same thing as saying, okay, I have 16 curves that are disjoint, I have other 16 curves that are not are disjoint, and these are not isomorphic. So this means there is no automorphism of the K3, in this case of the Kummer surface, sending these 16 first curves to the second one. And I say the answer is yes, but even more, it actually one can be more precise. So the answer depends on the rank, depends on rank of the Neron-Severi group of S, which we will show. I will recall a bit later in the school that this is the same as the Picard group of S. One can see in an easy way, depend on the rank Neron-Severi group of FS, and one can even more show, again, this we will see, I am anticipating something that we will see tomorrow, or that NSS is, call them then 20. This is true for any K3. And in fact, so rank of the Picard group, so think about the Picard group for the moment, just on the Neron-Severi group is 20, so the answer is no in this case. So Shioda was answering, and this actually depends on the moduli space of these Kummer surfaces. So Shioda himself together with Mitani were giving the proof of that. But if the Picard is less than 20, then the answer is yes. And one way to think about that is the following. Maybe do not anticipate too much. Well, just since you have seen this morning also Torai, take a generic. Then when you have an abelian surface, you can define the dual abelian surface. One should not care too much what it is. But if the polarization is not principal, so we have learned this morning what it is, not principally polarized, as we said this morning, then A and A, the dual, are not isomorphic, but it was shown, but was a paper by Hulek and Gritsenko, that Kummer A is isomorphic to Kummer A dual, so it was a Gritsenko-Hulek. Actually the paper was quite recent. So the answer is yes. Very recently, with one of the organizers of the school, so with Xavier, we have shown explicitly how to find this two set of intersecting curves that are disjoint, but not give, but are not isomorphic. So this as you say, a very old question, but until very short, it was not so explicit. So, and so recently, a paper together with Xavier we constructed sets of non-isomorphic disjoint set of disjoint 16 disjoint rational curves are non-isomorphic. So the result is more precise than that. So it depends from the polarization. We did not construct for any, but depending on the polarization, so in the line bundle that gives you the embedding, we could construct this disjoint set of rational curves. Okay. So even if you have Kummer surface, a very classical object, somehow there are a lot of interesting questions about the structure somehow. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say about Kummer surfaces, and let's go now back to the general theory of K3 surfaces and talk about basic properties. At least let's start with that. Surfaces, and what I want to talk about is going to the direction of moduli space and Torelli theorem, and in particular to show how lattice theory play an important role. So two things I will assume. So first fact is that all K3 surfaces are diffeomorphic. So topologically are the same, and we have computed, well, we have already computed in one example, and then we can do it in another example for Kummer surfaces, that then if S is K3, key top of S is equal to 24. Sorry, in particular, all diffeomorphic to the quartic, and we have computed then that the K top in that case is, or to the double cover, is 24. What I'm more going to show now is the structure of the second cohomology group with integer coefficients, which is H2, and which is in fact so we want to show now the following. The following theorem that, well, take always S is K3, we'll not always by this, and take the second cohomology with integer coefficients. Okay, so this is a lattice, and even more, we can describe it even more precisely. This means that is a free module, Z module of rank, so say more precisely, of rank 22, signature equal 319, and more precisely, it is isometric to the following lattice. Okay, isometric, I will explain several things now doing the proof. Isometric to the following lattice, which is three copies of U and two copies of P8. Well, what is this? Well, U is a called hyperbolic plane. Let's say hyperbolic lattice plane, full plane. Sorry. U is Z2, let's see, with this bilinear form 0, 1, 1, 0. See, it's a signature 1, 1, so this is why you have 3 here. And E8 is the unique, even unimodular lattice. And I will note this negative definite. And it is associated to the Dynkin diagram E8 that give you the way to recover the matrix of the bilinear form. So negative definite, and E8 can be seen as associated with the Dynkin diagram. So when I put a dot, is an element of the lattice with square minus 2, a generator square minus 2, and an arrow when the two generators meet. Okay, so the matrix of the bilinear form . So for me, a lattice comes always with the bilinear form. We'll see that. Or the bilinear form is then minus 2, 1, and then you can write down, it's called the Cartan matrix. So you see it already from here. So this is negative definite, rank 8. So you have 16 of that. 3 plus eigenvalue coming from here, 3 minus coming from that. But the interesting fact is that this is true for any k3. So for any k3, always the h2 has this lattice. And again, as I say, so we'll see when constructive period, well, this lattice is the lattice when you tensor I by C, where the period of the k3 lives. And again, you can use isometry of lattice, for example, is an important ingredient when you study automorphism of k3. So often you have to study isometry between lattices. But well, let's go back to that. I want to give an idea of the proof, how to show that this is free of rank 22 and so on. Ah, sorry, I was saying that I think. So I have 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great. So sorry. Okay, I can start then the proof, at least showing the first computations. Okay, first let's compute. We have a idea of the proof. So I will try to do a lot of details, but not everything. First of thing, let's compute that the rank is 22, and then we will care about the torsion here. Okay, because it, to be a free Z module, I have to show the no torsion. So idea of the proof. First step, let's compute the second Betti number of S, which is the rank of H2 SZ modulo the torsion. But well, this rank is the same as dimension of H2 SC, so where I tensor I with C. And we have seen already something for that, which H2 SC. Let's do it another way, sorry. I do don't want to do that. Sorry, just forget about the dimension of this. This is true, but we don't want to maybe to do that. Not immediately, at least. So, okay, you want to see that. And let's consider what we had. They want to use the topological Euler-Poincaré characteristic. So K top S, we know it is 24. So this is alternating sum of Betti numbers, B0 minus B1 plus B2 minus B3 plus B4. Okay, we have seen at the beginning, but we have seen here. So everything is simply connected. So this is 0 and this is 0. So B1 and B3 for K3 are 0. This is 1, is the lowest and the highest Lewis cohomology. So let's say with B2. So this tells me immediately that B2 is equal to 2. 22. One first thing. So the second thing, we want to see that there is no torsion. So let's see that we have no torsion in H2. So second one, we want to show that there is no torsion in H2Z. Because then we will equip H2Z of the cup product we have seen this morning to give a bilinear form, which is which is non-degenerate and it is unimodular, and then go on. Well, there is a theorem, so the universal coefficient theorem from topology. That the torsion part here is the same as the torsion part here. So this means that we have to show that we have no torsion. So if you remember at the beginning, I was telling you in the previous hour, if Q equal to zero, the regularity is zero, I can show that is simply connected. And in fact, so somehow one go back to show that there is no torsion here. And you do actually exactly as I'm going to do now. So assume for the contrary that we have an element, or let's say if tau is in H S Z, a torsion element, so this means it exists M bigger equal than 1 such that M tau is equal 0. But anytime you have a torsion element, so you can construct a cover and ramify. So one get so this means that one can construct a covering S tilde over S M to 1 and ramified. So this means again think about the topological Euler Poincaré characteristic. So we have then since this is unramified, K top S tilde is equal M times K top S, which is 24 times M. On the other hand, so again remember a bit the calculation with computation we did for Kummer. So we have our two form here, we know that it's K3. Then I can pull it back on S tilde and I have no zero in poles because I mean here it's just unramified. So let's call this pi. Since pi is unramified, we get K S tilde is trivial. Okay, it's the same argument as before. You pull back the form that you have on S. Since you have no ramification, your form remain without zero and poles, and so give you a trivialization of your canonical divisor here. And we use now what we have used all the time, the Noether formula. Tell a lot of things. So again, we have a key of OS tilde equal 1 divided by 12 k s tilde square plus k top s tilde. And on the other hand, this is h0 o s tilde minus h1 o s tilde plus h2 o s tilde. Alors, so I know that k s tilde is trivial. So this is a zero. K top S tilde is 24M divided by 12, divided by 12. So it's 2M. And this I know it is, let's say, well, let's just do another computation, then I will finish with that. So this is H0 S tilde is 1, so all the holomorphic form. So duality. And then, so the fact that, not duality, sorry, the fact that this is trivial. So it gives you 1 plus 1 minus H1. So 2 minus H1 OS tilde equal to 2M. Okay, this means that this is equal, less or equal than 2. Let's write this. Okay, and this is bigger or equal than 2. So I get one gets that m is equal to 1. And so, well, tau is 0. So no torsion. So we see that it is, so this concludes the fact that it is a free module of Frank 22. Then, so the next thing that we want to show, and okay, I will show you tomorrow, that's right, is that, well, I will do some small, recall some properties about lattices. So we have talked about lattices already this morning, but I will need something more. And I will give you some way how to see that this H2 is always equal to the lattice I was writing over there, U and E8, and so on. Okay, I'll stop here.